Darling, you have just begun by Dancing Lassie, but chapter 4. Jasker is lonely. It's an odd feeling for him. He's never really been prone to it. Lettenhove was probably the first time he'd felt totally lonely. With Geralt seemingly gone from his life forever, he'd been trapped in the city, far away from Ciri, unable to dip into his own river on a whim and head off to visit his family. He'd been utterly bereft. Before that, he'd never really experienced it. Growing up, he'd always had Mama and Auntie Irina and her girls. His siblings were frequent visitors. There was almost always one of them at Mama's. When he'd grown up and started traveling with Geralt, he'd always had the Witcher, while the inhabitants of almost every town they came across would flock to him. Now there's only Geralt and Ciri. The former is busy with chores and training during the day. The latter is breaking his heart. She is pulling increasingly away from his side. The other witchers have taken to her in a way they haven't to Jasker. Even surly, foul-mouthed Lambert has a soft spot for the young princess, though he tries to hide it with insults. She's increasingly joining them for weapons training, leaving Jasker to mope about on his own in the keep. He tried going down to watch once, but he seemed to disrupt the flow of the practice, and he's not been back since. Eskel and Lambert seemed particularly on edge, and Vesemir kept stopping in the middle of training to come over and ask Jasker yet another question about river gods. So Jasker is finding himself spending most of his time down by the river with Gwen. She doesn't seem to mind his presence and enjoys listening to him gossip about the affairs of the other rivers. She's a bit out of the loop, so he makes sure she's all caught up on who's fighting with whom. Ismina and Adelaide's little tryst ended badly, and Ismina is currently persona non grata in Mama's territory. He brings his lute down and composes by the riverbank. She offers praise and criticism where due, but is mostly content to sit quietly and bask in the music. It's nice, and he really appreciates having a family member close by, but she's only one very quiet companion. Geralt, Jasker admits, is doing his best. In the evenings, he tries hard to include Jasker in discussions and draw him into games of dice and cards. When all else seems to fail, he drags Jasker back to their room and fucks him gently under the furs. Contrary to his physical stature, Geralt prefers soft, sweet sex. He likes to take his time, exploring every nook and crevice of Jasker's body with his fingers and lips, before rocking slowly into him and unhurriedly bring them both to completion. That's not to say Geralt doesn't also appreciate it when Jasker decides to take charge, hold him down, and make him beg for mercy! It's just... And Jasker realizes how awful this is. He can't help but slightly resent Geralt. Ciri is spending more and more of her time with the Witcher, basking in his guidance and subtle affection, and Jasker is thrilled that they're developing a close bond. Really, he is. But she's seeking him out less and less. She adores swordplay, and while the weather allowed, she was excitedly telling him about her progress running the killer, but it's not an interest he can share with her. They both know it, no matter how assiduously he listens to her tales. He prefers the arts, and while she appreciates his music and the poems he composes for her enjoyment, she has no interest in learning his craft herself. He wishes his family were here. They seem too far away. Adelaide would listen to him and soothe his fears, while Ina would call him a fool but still impart useful advice. Vida would stand silently behind him in her usual manner of support, a constant, trusted presence. Etta, as always, would be loud and flamboyant. She'd fill up this dreary keep with color and revelry. But it's Trava he misses most. The only two sons. They've always had a close bond, outnumbered as they are by their sisters. Trava would help Jasker smooth over whatever this anxiety is that the other witchers feel about him. He'd be charming and friendly, but with an edge to him that would prevent the others from excluding them. He may not be Mama's oldest, but he's her right hand, her diplomat. Jasker supposes, had things been different, he might have been jealous of the effortless way Trava appears to sail through life, except his brother has never hesitated to come to Jasker's aid and defense. Jasker wants Mama as well. He's not seen her since before the Nilfgaardian War. The last time they'd been face to face, she'd banished him to Lettenhove, and he'd hated her for it! He doesn't hate her anymore. He just misses her. He wants to apologize to her for, all right, he can admit to himself, being a bit of a brat. He wants to tell her he loves her and hear her say it back. They didn't say it the last time they parted, each too angry with the other, and it's been weighing on him for months. More than anything, Jasker wants her advice, because raising a child It turns out it's hard, and as the youngest, he has no frame of reference. His own childhood seems so long ago. Rationally, he knows he should expect Ciri to display some mood swings, but are they supposed to be so extreme? And is she supposed to be so aggressive? Lately, the little nudges she gives him when he teases her have become much harder, and she seems more irritated than amused by his quibs. There's a truculent undercurrent to her now, and she'll often try and wrestle one of the witchers to the ground in a surprise attack. And they encourage such behavior. When out of the blue, she'd barreled in the Yasker one morning, he'd almost tumbled down the stairs, only narrowly catching himself on the wall. She'd apologized, but begrudgingly, while castigating him about the need to keep his guard up. He's worried, but when he tried to ask her if anything was wrong, she'd snapped at him and gone off to polish swords with Eskel. He misses the little girl who used to climb him like a tree and get dirt all over his fine clothes. The little girl who was entranced by his stories and always happy to see him. His darling little princess who adored his company. She hasn't referred to him as Papa in a week. Geralt thinks he's overreacting.
She's growing up, Yasker. It's a difficult time for her, and she's surrounded by grown men. It can't be easy for her. There must be women things she doesn't want to talk to us about.
Yasker laughs at him as he curls in closer to Geralt's side. It's moments like this when they cuddle together late at night which make all the other unpleasantness worth it. Women things. He muffles his snarls of laughter into Geralt's neck.
You know what I mean.
Geralt grumbles, embarrassed.
No, I have no clue.
Yasker protests with false innocence. Please enlighten me, Geralt. What sorts of women things should we be on the lookout for? Geralt tries to shove him off the bed, but Yasker clings to him like a limpet.
I don't know. You're the one with sisters. There wasn't exactly much feminine influence growing up here.
Yasker continues to tease him, but Geralt has sparked an idea that grows in the back of Yasker's mind. He does have sisters! He briefly considers asking Gwen to help him with Ciri, but their relationship is too new to ask this much of her. Yasker would love to invite Adelaide to visit because she's sweet and good-natured, and he defies anyone to sit down for a chat with her and not like her by the end. But Ina is the sister with the experience he needs, so he says goodbye to his pride and writes a suitably humble letter begging her to come and talk with Ciri and goes down to the Gwynlech to ask the river herself to deliver it. Ina does not reply, but as Yasker had fully expected, comes tearing up north to sort out her little brother. She doesn't come up to the keep, but instead transmits a jarring greeting into Yasker's brain, leaving his ears ringing. Perhaps she thinks all this time away from the Yaruga has made him deaf? Ciri is not impressed when he requests her company that morning. Geralt is no help either. He's been promising Ciri a turn with an actual steel sword instead of a practiced wooden one, and the previous evening had declared that she was now proficient enough to have a few swings. Neither liked the idea of her wasting what little daylight they have at this time of year to accompany Yasker. Ciri grumbles and whines, and Geralt backs her up! Yasker has wanted to strangle Geralt many times during their long acquaintance, but never more so than just now. It's only the presence of the other witches around the breakfast table that forces him to keep his temper. He will be having a serious talk with Geralt about this later.
Perhaps I should have been clearer. This is not a request, Ciri. Ina has come all this way to check up on us both and say hello. You will not insult her by choosing sword practice over her visit.
Yasker.
Geralt still tries to object, but Yasker cuts him off.
Geralt, mama help me if you keep this up. I'll turn that hot spring you're all so fond of cold every time you so much as dip a toe in. Don't for a moment think that is beyond my powers.
Lambert snorts quietly up to the side and mutters something no doubt rude and derogatory to Cohen.
This isn't fair!
Ciri complains, her cheeks beginning to puff out in the beginnings of a truly epic tantrum.
Tough!
Yasker grinds his teeth.
Go and get your cloak!
She slams her fists down on the table as she stands, causing the tableware to tremble at the force of her blow. Yasker manages to get up more sedately to collect his own cloak, despite desperately wanting to follow her example and have his own meltdown! Ciri refuses to talk to him as they make their way down to the river, angrily kicking any stone that gets in her way. She doesn't even pretend that she's pleased to see Ina, who's wrapped up warmly and sitting primly on a felled tree trunk. Ina herself had been prepared to greet Yasker with her usual rebuke, which all her family knows is her way of saying, I love you. But instead, witnessing Ciri's behavior, she raises an inquiring eyebrow at her brother over the girl's head. He doesn't even try to hide his desperation. She begins by making some inane small talk, trying to cajole Ciri into calming down and making proper conversation. Ciri irritably grunts back half-hearted responses. Ina's expression becomes more and more pinched, and Jaskar fears he's correct. This is not just puberty rearing its ugly head. Something is wrong with Ciri.
Given the rather harsh environment up here,
Ina finally disperses with polite conversation and gets to the real reason for her visit. I think it would be a good idea if I check you both over.
Ciri, you first. Then you can get back to your sword practice.
Ina knows how to coax the girl.
Jaskar, go away. Come back in half an hour.
Half an hour later, and Jaskar is not sure which of the darling witches back at the Cape he's going to behead first! Geralt is worried about Jaskar. His river god has been uncharacteristically withdrawn and has begun isolating himself from the rest of the group. He knows this is partly his brother's fault. They're still suspicious and show it. But he needs Jaskar to be his usual intrusive self and force them to spend more time in his company, not quietly withdraw. When has Jaskar ever done anything quietly? Why has he chosen to start now? Lambert and Eskel will warm to him once they've spent enough time in his company to realize he isn't altering their behavior. With them will come Cohen, who is cautiously trying to stay on the good side of everyone. Jaskar will feel better once the tension eases. Geralt just needs him to keep trying to accommodate his brothers in the meantime. Dragging Ciri away this morning has not helped. Lambert grumbles at him, and Eskel looks unimpressed.
Are we to expect an invasion of Orisa this winter?
Geralt looks at Eskel, unamused.
Ina would have no issue with marching right into the keep at the Fancy Tucker. If she's meeting Jaskar and Ciri by the river, it means she's respecting our home.
Eskel does not look convinced as he faces Geralt, sword drawn. They clash, blocking and parrying, before Geralt manages to get in close enough to grapple, forcing Eskel to drop his weapon or have his arm broken.
You're distracted. That was sloppy.
Geralt comments, handing Eskel his sword.
I don't like that there are a bunch of creatures I've only recently heard of with the power to swim up easily to our hidden fortress. Who knows what trouble they could bring?
They've been around for centuries without your knowledge,
Geralt points out.
Why should suddenly knowing about them change anything?
Because you've decided to play happy families with one of them and open the door for him,
Eskel snarls in frustration.
You're raising a fugitive princess together, and I like Ciri, I really do, but you've painted a giant target on your backs. I don't know him or his kind well enough to be sure they won't sell us out when the armies after her start trying to hunt you down.
They've already rescued her from those armies once, when I couldn't. You're judging him to be weak and a coward without even giving him a chance.
Geralt refutes angrily. Lambert and Cohen stop their own practice to shamelessly listen in. Vesemir has noticed their lack of activity from the other side of the yard and has started to make his way over.
He makes me uneasy, Geralt, Eskel insists. You can't expect us to welcome him with open arms just because he's wormed his way into your bed, especially when you never mentioned what he was before turning up with him.
That's not his fault, it's on me. You weren't even trying to get to know him.
He smells weird,
Eskel snaps, bringing Geralt up short. Eskel seems almost embarrassed by his outburst, pathetic as it sounds, but Cohen pipes up in his defense. He's right. Whenever I try to catch a scent, I get more than just a smell. It's strange. Geralt resists the urge to groan. He knows what they mean, but he's not sure how to explain it. Until he took a dip in Jaskar's own river with him, he never really understood Jaskar's scent either, had ignored it, as he had ignored so many hints of Jaskar's true nature. It was only after that fateful swim that he realized that Jaskar didn't just give off a particular smell, he also gave off flashes of him, of his river. When they're alone in their room and Geralt lets himself bury his nose in Jaskar's neck, he gets the expected scent of body odor and whatever perfume Jaskar is currently favoring, but also senses something else. He hears the thwack, thwack, thwack of the loom treadles as the hundred of weavers create beautiful, extravagant cloth in Lettenhove's warehouses. His head is filled with the numerous plays performed in its theaters. He can taste the smoked fish that hundreds of travelers catch and cook along the Pankratz's banks. He can feel the powerful webbed feet of hundreds of ducks frantically paddling below the water. Before binding himself to Jaskar, he'd been unable to understand these strange sensations either, had not been fully able to concentrate on them. Now he does. Yaskar is not just a powerful water entity in a man's body. He is also the river. He is every molecule of water that ever has or ever will flow downstream. It makes him both incredibly powerful and incredibly vulnerable at the same time. If anything happens to his river, then Yaskar would... Geralt doesn't dare contemplate it.
It's a river god thing,
he tries to explain. He has no idea how he's going to take this forward, but that's when the deity in question comes barging into the training ground, a squirming Ciri clutched tightly in his furious grip. Geralt is vaguely aware of Ina trailing in after them, but his attention is wrestled away by Yaskar's livid expression. He is also giving off a certain aura, the snow around them melting into steaming puddles and covering his feet. How could you? He fumes, blue eyes flashing. The meltwater is creeping outwards towards the witchers. Lambert, Eskel, and Cohen automatically reach for their swords, readying themselves for battle.
Yaskar?
He questions, putting himself between the god and his brothers. He's not really sure which of them he's trying to protect.
How could you be such a moron?
Yaskar shouts at him, shaking Ciri's arm. She looks up at Yaskar with tears beginning to form at the corners of her eyes. Geralt reaches out a hand towards her, but the bard pulls her behind him with a jolt.
No!
Yaskar spits, saliva flying out of his mouth in his rage.
I'm not letting any of you lay a hand on her! Not after what you've done! What the fuck are you on about?
Lambert yells over.
We haven't done anything to her! Now let her go, you hurt her! Fuck off, Lambert!
Yaskar yells in fury, his voice echoing throughout the courtyard. The water on the ground lunges threateningly towards Lambert.
Yaskar, calm down. We don't know what you're talking about.
Yaskar rounds on him.
No, you don't! And doesn't that just speak for your utter incompetence? What I'm talking about, darling,
Yaskar snarls the last of her teeth bared,
is how you managed to poison her with your ineptitude!